So, around a year ago, I read The Promise of Blood, which is the first book in the Powder Mage trilogy, and I thought it was decent. I didn't particularly like it, but there were parts of it I liked, but overall it sort of fell flat for me. I didn't get the hype. But I just read The Crimson Campaign, which is the sequel, after people were, nagging at me about it and telling me, "Oh, just no, keep reading, it gets better." And now, honestly, I get it. I get the hype. This is a really good series.
This is the introduction song. It's not very good, but it's not too long.
In a lot of ways, this book is kind of a perfect sequel because it keeps all of the stuff that I really liked about the first one, or most of it anyways, and it fixes most of the problems I had. Yeah, I know that's not a whole lot of detail there, but this is just the intro, so let's keep going. This book starts up right after the last one ended. So Taniel has apparently killed Kresimir, but the Kez are still going to war with Adro. So Tamas is leading the fight against them. Taniel is kind of in a drug-induced stupor at the beginning, and Adamat, his family is still—they've still been kidnapped, so he's got to go rescue them. And just like the last book, the plot mostly just follows these three characters, and they're all kind of doing their own thing, so their storylines are somewhat disconnected. But they are also more connected than they were in the last book. Because there is some sort of big conspiracy within Adro that they all see different faces of. They see different aspects of it and interact with the conspiracy in different ways. So they don't feel like just separate stories within the same book. They do feel like one story. And I think that's a very good thing. I think that's a very big improvement from the first book because in the first one, yeah, the three plot lines did feel kind of disconnected at times. Another thing that I think is really, really great is that the pacing in this sort of seesaws, I guess, like, man, I don't know if that's a good word for it, but it sort of goes back and forth. Like when one story is kind of slowed down and it needs, it's taken time to just catch its breath, the other ones are going more fast-paced and have more stuff happening. And it goes back and forth like this so that there's never really a point where things aren't happening. Like, there's always something happening in at least one plot line, but at the same time, it never feels like things are going too quick or that there's not enough time to really figure out what's going on. There's always moments of calm, and there's always moments where stuff is going on and you're at the edge of your seat. So I think that's actually a really impressive feat that Brian McClellan was able to pull off with this book. So the pacing in this is just about perfect. You can get through it pretty quickly, even though it's a really long book. At least I got through it fairly quickly. Let's get a little more specific, though. So Tomas's story follows him, actually after a battle at the beginning of the book goes wrong, and he's winds up stranded in Kez with a couple thousand soldiers, and so he winds up having to sort of go around them while being pursued by them. And that's basically his plot line throughout the whole book. It's a little more complicated than that at the end, but for the most part, it is pretty simple and straightforward. And I did like it, but I never really. I feel like there was a missed opportunity with Tamas's military genius, or his supposed military genius, at least. And I'll get a little more into this in the spoiler section, but I just never really got the feeling that he was this genius that he'd been built up as. Adamat's story is more complicated because, again, he's trying to rescue his family. He's trying to find out where they are, and then he has to save them, and that requires him to go around and do a bunch of, well, side quests, I guess is one way of putting it, so that he has all the allies and the resources that he needs to do it. And while I don't think that would be great on its own, all the development that Adamat goes through makes it work really well, because in the last book, I don't think he had all that much personality beyond just being, smart. But in this one, we really do feel for him. We feel how much he loves his family, how much he loves his wife, how much he loves his kids, and we don't want anything bad to happen to them. So there's a lot of tension whenever he's doing anything, really. And that makes this plot line work really, really well. And then, of course, there's Taniel, and his is, in some ways, it's the weakest, but in other ways, it's definitely the strongest. Because at the beginning, I liked it because it gives some insight into the political situation in Adro, which I think has been kind of neglected in these books, to be honest. And the end is really good for some of the same reasons, but also just because we're really seeing more up close and personal, we're getting a more up close and personal look at Kresimir and what's going on with the Kez, and Taniel is also just, you know, doing cool shit, he's being a badass, so that's cool. But there is a dip in the middle, and that part, I mean, like I said, it didn't bother me too much, because even when his storyline isn't great, then Adamat and Tamas's are really good, but it still does go on for a while, where his, when the his parts of the chapters come up, I wasn't bored necessarily, but I wasn't that interested in him seeing the conspiracy, because, like I said, there is a conspiracy in Adro, and Tamas suspects pretty early on that there are people in the general staff of the army that are traitors, but he doesn't do a whole lot of investigating. It's mostly just, I think people are traitors, and then he continues fighting, and it's, it could have been done a lot better. But what saves it is that Taniel goes through a lot of really, really good character development, and his is actually a lot better than Adamat's, because Adamat's is, you know, he's a fairly simple character overall, and he's likable, don't get me wrong, it's just, there's not all that much to him, and I think Tamas is kind of the same. I'll get to him a little bit more in a minute, but I think Taniel of the three is definitely the most relatable and definitely the most nuanced. See, in the last one, he was definitely having some issues with addiction, like he was becoming addicted to gunpowder and becoming dependent on it, and he also seemed to be suffering from a little bit of depression. And at the beginning of this one, he is getting that even worse, and he also seems to have some mild PTSD thrown on top of that, because, hey, he saw a god, and he thinks he killed him. You find out pretty early on that Kresimir is still alive, but he thinks he killed a god, and he saw some nasty shit, so at the very beginning of the book, he's been on a bender for like a week and a half, I think, and when you see him in this drug den, you're thinking, wow, he has fallen really far. I want to see how he'll build himself back up, how he'll get back to being normal, but it just sort of goes away after that. Like, his addiction doesn't seem to bother him in the slightest, and that's, that was disappointing. I would have liked to see him actually have to overcome that, but, I mean, I guess they just didn't want it to be a focus of the story, but if they didn't want it to be a focus, then they probably shouldn't have brought it up in the first place. There's also the fact that he's kind of scared shitless by all this stuff that's happening around him, but he is still rising to the occasion, you know, he's still doing what needs to be done. So, I did, you know, he's still a really nice, relatable character, and, you know, you do see him actually be a badass in this one. Like, in the first one, I never really got that impression that he was a badass, at least not until near the end, like at the very end when he actually shoots Kresimir. That was pretty cool, but beyond that, I didn't really get it, whereas in this one, you see him go into the fray and fuck some shit up, so yeah, okay, he definitely is a badass here. Other than all that, the only part of his personality that I didn't really like, and I'm not even sure I'd call this part of his personality, is his relationship with Kapol, who is the savage, quote-unquote, girl that follows him around and has all that weird magic and shit. And, I mean, don't get me wrong, I buy them as friends, and I definitely feel that Kapol has romantic feelings towards him, even though she never talks. Like, you can definitely tell just through her actions. I just didn't really buy him being into her. I just thought that was weird. Not to mention that when she's pursuing him throughout this book, and I mean, I get it. I get that that's a common thing in fantasy especially. Like, a man is just not interested in a woman, or he's trying to convince himself that he's not, but she's still pursuing him and going after him until eventually his willpower breaks down and he admits, like, okay, I'm totally into her. But Kapol's actions border on sexual harassment at times. Like for real. Because there's a point where she gets on a horse, that, like, they're both going to ride on a horse, and she gets on and forces him to go behind her, so he has to put his arms around her, and she sort of, like, leans back against his chest and stuff. And I'm like, Taniel, you need to contact HR, because she needs to have a stern talking to. That's just kind of, like, come on, girl. You're not supposed to do that. And then there's the matter of the laundress from the first book, who I don't even think I mentioned in my first review, just because she's kind of a side character in that book. And in this one, she has a little bit more of a role, But she does still feel kind of pointless until, like, near the end, where they're clearly building her up as, you know, some sort of person that's going to become really important later, but also, I don't know exactly how, and there's not a whole lot of foreshadowing to that effect, so most of her focus in this book, as well as in the last one, just feels more like she's viewing events from a different angle. Which, don't get me wrong, that's fine, it's just that she's not a particularly interesting, complex character, so I just, I don't know, I just don't have many strong feelings about her. But all the fun stuff from the first book is still here, you know, the magic is still really cool, I fucking love the powder mages especially, like, that's just a really neat, unique type of magic that I have not seen anywhere else. All the other types of magic beyond powder mages is also cool, and, you know, the world building is kind of fun, but like I said, I do wish they would go a little bit more into detail about the politics in Adro and the politics in other countries surrounding Adro, because, you know, Adro is forming a new form of government. They're transitioning from a monarchy into a republic, and, like, I'd like to know, okay, where did they get that idea? Because, like, in the real world, like, the French Revolution, which this is pretty clearly based off of, republics had existed for thousands of years before that, and I just feel like there was an opportunity missed there. Like, you could have gone into some more history of the world, and you could have had some more infighting between the factions that still wanted a republic, but they wanted it to be slightly different or something. I just feel like there was a missed opportunity there, but, you know, it's still a good world-building overall. Or, still good world-building overall. I don't feel like re-recording that whole take, so we're just gonna stick with that. There's also the matter of the prose in this book. Now, a little over a week ago, I saw Daniel Green's review of Uncanny Collateral, which is also written by Brian McClellan, and in that he complained that McClellan's writing is a little too straightforward. Like, there's no pizzazz to it, there's no poetry to it, and I have to disagree with that. I think that the straightforward nature really, really works well for a book of this type. Like, it prevents things from getting too confusing or too, what's the word, off-putting for new readers. And honestly, I just am not a big fan of, like, purple prose in general, so that works for me. And I think it works great for the action scenes as well, because that's just straightforward. You know, you just know what's going on. If you liked the first book, then you'll definitely like this one. If you are like me and you didn't like the first book, then I would still check this one out, because I really do feel like it fixes the majority of the problems I had. And if you haven't read either of the first two books, then, well, if you're into more modern, non-traditional fantasy, or at least fantasy where certain aspects of the story and some of the characters and the world building aren't really traditional, then I would definitely check this one out, because you'll probably like this. And now we're going to go into the spoiler corner, so if you don't want to have that happen, then you should leave now. Bye. The only really big spoiler that I want to talk about here is Tamas's battle with Prince Bion about halfway through the book. So the thing is that when Tamas got trapped in Kez, and he and a couple thousand men had to, you know, go around the mountains, they were pursued by about two or three times their number in cavalry. And the thing is that his men were mostly infantry, and he had his entire powder mage cabal with him, and no cavalry or artillery or privilege or anything, but the people pursuing them also don't seem to have any privilege with them. That's mages, if you forgot. Privileged are, like, regular, you know, fire, lightning mages, all that. So for a couple of weeks, they're on a super hard march through the forests and everything, and then they reach a river, which has a bridge going across it. And this is really the area where Tamas's strategic genius, or tactical genius, excuse me, could have been shown off a lot. Like, he could have come up with some sort of cunning battle plan to destroy their pursuers and then get them to safety. But he really doesn't. Now let me explain. They reach a river which has a whole bunch of flat land around it. So what they do is he sends a bunch of men ahead and has them actually destroy the bridge, and then he tells the other men that, yeah, it was swept away, so we're stuck here, we have to fight. And right off the bat, that just doesn't make any sense. Because while it might sound kind of cool on paper to, like, have to force your men to fight, like, offer them no retreat and they'll fight their hardest, that is pretty stupid. It really doesn't make any sense. Like, one, if your men found out about that, they probably would have mutinied. And two, you never, ever want to put all of your eggs into one basket like that. You want to leave a line of retreat open. That's just stupid. And then after that, he has them build up some defenses, but only leaves them, like, halfway finished so that the cavalry will think, oh, okay, we got them, and then they'll just charge in, and then they actually dug a trench around as well, which got hidden by fog, and then a bunch of the cavalry fall into it, and then the infantry fire at them when they're all confused, and, you know, eventually they do win the battle. But here's the thing. Some defenses certainly would be helpful, yes, but in Napoleonic warfare, if there's just infantry, then they're probably going to beat cavalry. Because the thing is, back then they had these things called, this formation called an infantry square, and I'll see if I can find some decent pictures of it. But basically, what it was that the infantry would get into, you know, a square, and they'd all have their guns with their bayonets pointed out. And the thing is that when they were in that formation, the horses would not charge at their line. It would just ride around them, which would allow the infantry to shoot at them until eventually they shot either the horse or the rider. And so they just would not be able to attack them that way. But the thing is that if the cavalry was supported by infantry or artillery, which were shooting at the squares, then, well, the soldiers would have had to break out of that formation, otherwise they'd get killed. So in this situation, Tamas and his men do have a pretty significant advantage. As long as they have time to get into formation, they will absolutely decimate all the cavalry that come at them. And as far as I'm aware, they didn't have any privilege or anything with them, and they didn't have any powder mages, certainly, and Tamas had a bunch of powder mages, so they had multiple advantages, and Tamas just made this really unnecessarily complex plan, which had a lot of risks to it, and it just got a lot of his men killed. So what I'm getting at is that he really just does not come across as any sort of genius in this, and that's a pretty big disappointment, because I actually was looking forward to reading that sort of thing. And again, with Faye, like, at the very end of the book, it reveals that she is a privilege, and not only that, but she can use magic without using gloves, which is, I mean, I guess that's kind of cool, but it's never really foreshadowed in any way, and I'm not quite sure what it's gonna mean going forward, so she's still not that interesting. But that's about everything. I don't have much else to add, so if you like The Powder Mage, then definitely check out this next book. And if you came this far, then be sure to, like, you know, comment and like and subscribe and check out my Patreon page and my Discord and, you know, all that stuff I'm supposed to say at the end here. Bye.